But then before that, we'll just quickly go on to this very interesting panel, which is about youth fellows. So these are a bunch of young, less than 20-year-olds, and we wanted to really have them here to really listen to some of the great ideas that they actually have, because they are the future of our country without a doubt, because they are actually going to be creating transformations which are going to run this world in the future. May I actually invite the speakers here? So we have Raja Chaudhary, who's going to be moderating this session. Raja is going to be speaking to us on another session, but Raja himself is an amazing personality who's like a Babaji. He's like the next Jaggi Vasudev in making. Or maybe Ravi Shankar if you hate him, because I find him to be fairly interesting. But then we'll not talk about the ticket to heaven market here. But then Raja, over to you for moderating the session. Can I have Piyush Ghosh, who's from the Optimist Citizen, Aditi Parekh, from Student Think Tank of India, Pratish Bhavnani. Pratish, in fact, very interestingly, Pratish is also my Aditi? Son's classmate, if I'm not wrong, from Delhi Public School, so great to have him here. Pratish, Shanti Murmu.
So I'll track all of you.
And then, of course, Priya Radhakrishnan.
And Shanti Murmu.
So Priya's father is also here. I think he must be a very proud man that we are having him. So thanks a lot for joining us in person as well, please. Thank you. So Raja, over to you, please.
Thank you. Have you got mics for everybody? Or everybody's mic'd up? Can you hear me?
You have exactly 42 minutes.
42?
Yes.
Okay, I'll just take 2 minutes so they get 40. Okay, how many people here have heard of Ashoka? The global foundation, the global organization. Yes? Okay. And for those of you who don't know, Ashoka is one of the leading organizations in the world for social entrepreneurship cultivation, which is cultivating the next generation of entrepreneurs who have a social impact in mind, transformational entrepreneurs. And they've just started a new program, which I'm so happy to meet all of you, called the Youth Venturers. The Ashoka Youth Venturers Worldwide, which is taking young people under the age of 20 and cultivating entrepreneurship in them. And these are already entrepreneurs, and you'll hear their stories just now, but they are also cultivating them and supporting them in a global platform. That's quite amazing. So I'm not going to take up any more time. I'm going to introduce you one by one, and I'd like you all to take 2 minutes and just tell us who you are and what you're doing. And don't worry, if you speak in Hindi, that's fine as well, okay? Okay, theek hai.
Hello everyone, I am Piyush Ghosh and I represent an organization which is in the business of selling happiness through positive stories. And we do it through a newspaper called the Optimist Citizen, which is a purely positive newspaper spreading only positive news from across the world with a mission to initiate and stimulate positive actions. That's my organization.
Short and sweet. And next is Aditi.
Hi, my name is Aditi Parekh and I'm the Program Director of Student Think Tank for India. STTI was founded by a brilliant young man, Akash Baidi, in 2014, and it was originally envisioned as a small think tank of college students who were engaging with issues that are significant in India. But over time, what we realized that this really needs to start at the school level, because there is a structured need to promote civic engagement and critical thinking amongst this age group. Because where are all these business leaders who can create shared value going to come from? Where are these NGO leaders going to come from? With the amount of crises that we're facing, we need a structured approach and can't just rely on a few people whose change of hearts, you know, will really get them to engage with society. So we conduct programs in schools across India. We're a 30-member team of moderators who are educators in the making, who try to have dialogue-based sessions with students. We don't believe in lecturing. We've had enough of it ourselves. So we have the baatcheet sessions where we take issues like understanding corruption, understanding the media, understanding gender, and really promote the habit of asking questions, because that is the root of changing minds. That is where change is going to come from.
Thank you. That's great. Aditi. And next is Pratish.
Hello, I'm Pratish Bhavnani, and I represent a campaign called Cry for Help. We started 3 years ago, and we aim at helping teenagers in dealing with problems like bullying, self-harm, peer pressure, etc., etc. I think a lot of people don't pay much attention to all these problems. But what we really need to think here is that if a child is being bullied and is on the verge of committing suicide, he won't be able to actually lead the organizations that are that we want them to lead. And that's something that is really important. And I was one of those kids who was bullied back in class 6. I used to go home, cry under the pillow, and that's how I prepared myself for the next day. So we aim at establishing self-help groups in schools, because we believe that who can help teenagers than teenagers themselves, so that they can come together, they share their problem, they share their stories. Now these teenagers, the student counselors, they stay in constant touch with professional counselors so that they can alert them in case there is something to worry about. And that is how we have been progressing. It works in a well-structured manner. We organize flash mobs so that people know that something like a cry for help exists, so that it creates a sense of curiosity in the mind of the students, that so that they would listen to us in the workshops. These workshops are also conducted by people who have gone through these problems. For example, if it's a workshop for bullying, I would be conducting that so that the person can relate with me and they come to us for one-to-one counseling sessions.
Nice.
That's how we go about it.
And do you have an online platform as well for this?
Yes.
Great. Shanti?
Namaskar. I'm Shanti Murmu. परिवर्तन का फाउंडर हूं मैं ओडिशा की एक बहुत छोटी गांव से आई हूं और अभी मैं कलिंगा इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ सोशल साइंस में पढ़ रही हूं जहां पे 25,000 आदिवासी छात्र छात्राएं पढ़ रहे हैं और वहां पे हम लोग को पढ़ाई के साथ-साथ बहुत सारे चीजें सिखाई दी जाती है और जैसे कि एक प्रोजेक्ट चल रहा है यूनेपीएफ का लाइफ स्किल एजुकेशन प्रोग्राम और वहां से उसको बेस करके मैं मेरा परिवर्तन जो प्रोजेक्ट में शुरू की और बेसिकली परिवर्तन का एम यह है कि टू प्रमोट गर्ल्स एजुकेशन क्योंकि मेरे कम्युनिटी में कहते हैं कि लड़की को पढ़ा के क्या लाभ मिलेगा ट्राइबल एरिया में यही सोचते हैं बोलते हैं बेटी घर की पराई होती है तो इसलिए उन लोग को पढ़ाने के लिए कोई जरूरत नहीं है सोचते हैं तो हम लोग प्रमोट करते हैं गर्ल्स एजुकेशन को और दूसरी चीज यह है कि टू स्टॉप अर्ली मैरिज बहुत जल्द ही शादी करवा देते हैं तो हम लोग सोच रहे हैं परिवर्तन के माध्यम में कि स्टॉप हो जाए और हम लोग का जो अर्ली मैरिज और तीसरी चीज यह है कि जो हेल्थ रिमूव करना चाहते हैं ब्लाइंड बिलीफ हेल्थ के बारे में जैसे कि अभी इंसान चंद्रमा में पहुंच गया पर मेरे गांव के लोगों अभी भी लड़के लोगों को जब ड्यूरिंग मेंस्ट्रुएशन उन लोगों को घर में रखते हैं और ये जो एक बंद कमरे में रखते हैं तो इसके लिए उन लोग पर्सनल हाइजीन मेंटेन नहीं कर पाते हैं और इट लीड्स टू इन्फेक्शन और ये इतना दुख की बात है जो लाइफ लॉन्ग और लड़की जो प्रॉब्लम फेस करती है वो हम लोग जानते हैं जो मैं वही कम्युनिटी से आई हूँ देख रही हूँ तो इसलिए मैंने सोची मैं यही सब ऊपर में इश्यूज के ऊपर में मैं काम करूंगी और दूसरी चीज ये है कि जो कंजप्शन और लोकल लिकोर उसका हम रिमूव करना चाहते हैं क्योंकि कितनी वो दिस एडिक्शन कितनी परिवार को बिछड़े हैं और आर्थिक अवस्था भी बहुत ही कम हुए है और बच्चों को पढ़ने के लिए भी पैसा नहीं होता है इसकी वजह से तो हम लोग क्रिएटिंग करते हैं अवेयरनेस प्रोग्राम हम लोग का कम्युनिटी में जैसे कि रोल प्लेज रैलीज और उसके साथ साथ ग्रुप डिस्कशन करते हैं लीफलेट्स पोस्टर सब बांटते हैं और मैं अकेले नहीं करती हूँ मेरे साथ अंगनवाड़ी वर्कर आशा कर्मी और लोकल यूथ एडोलेसेंट्स जो है उन लोग के साथ काम कर रही हूँ और इस प्रोग्राम इम्प्लीमेंटेशन होके अभी देख रहे हैं बहुत ही चेंजेस आया है
Thank you. And last but not least is Priya.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Priya Radhakrishnan, and I'm a co-founder of a Bangalore-based organization called Jazba. Now, Jazba in Hindi means a strong spirit or a strong desire to do something. And what we do is to foster the charitable quality of the performing arts in young people, teenagers, and adults alike. So we organize arts-related events for people who come from schools like myself, who come from backgrounds like myself, because they don't have a platform to show what they can do. They don't have a platform to express themselves artistically. We don't have resources like that in our country, unfortunately. And through giving them these opportunities to perform, we also want to let them know that through what they're doing, they can bring about a lot of social change. Arts are a very, very effective tool to touch lives. Along with just reaching out to people in this way, we also like to conduct workshops with people who come from more underprivileged backgrounds because they have no access at all to arts education. And the point of arts education, it's not a privilege to us, right? It's a right, because it's so important when you look at the cognitive and psychological development of a child. And a lot of people in our country don't have access to that. So in a broader perspective, through our events, we're trying to create that mental change to show people that arts are not a privilege, they're not a commodity, but they're a way of life. They're our right to it. So that's what we do through Jazba.
Very nice. So what I'll do is I'm going to ask a few questions, and then I'll open it up to all of you who want to speak to the group, young group here. But tell us, how old are all of you? How old are you?
I'm 20.
20?
20.
18.
18?
I'm 17.
17, good God. So I'm trying to remember when I was 17 and 18, you know, if I'd even talked like this at all. So, I mean, hats off to all of you. I think that this new generation is hopefully going to fix a lot of the messes we've made and fix the world in some way. I hope so.
And,
but I want to ask you a question, and I'll take it. We'll start on that and then come back this way, which is that, you know, what was a key moment in your life growing up, in your teenagers' years, that made you want to become a social entrepreneur? How did this trigger? What happened to you?
So I've always been quite an outspoken person, and I think ever since I was a child, I've always believed that our generation has probably seen the biggest dynamic shift because of the world opening up, globalization, because of the coming in of social media, the age of technology. And we are plagued by any social issues. It's not that things like the economy, things like gender violence just affect our parents, or it's something that's far away from us. It's something that's really close to us. It's something that plagues us as well. However, along with being affected with this, I'm not going to say we don't have the voice to express ourselves. I'm going to say that our voice is not treated on the same standing as people older than us. It's treated as something subordinate, right? And me being an artist myself, I realized how we're not taken seriously, how arts are not considered a profession. But
how old were you when this aha moment occurred?
Probably around 14 years old, 13 or 14 years old. So I recognized through my personal experiences how hard it is for an artist to flourish. But at the same time, I realized that when you sing to a group of elders, when you sing in an orphanage, when you teach them how they can use arts to foster happiness in their own lives, it makes a difference. And that's the side of artistic performance that we're not seeing. So I always dabbled in a bit of social work. I sing in a choir still that, you know, we sing for a lot. We're a charitable choir, basically. We sing for charity events. And that's how it struck me that just because I'm taking up art seriously doesn't mean I should be the only one having this feeling of community through art. I want other people to get a feel of it, to realize it. More than anything, I want other parents to know that your child has a talent and it can really be something big. So
thank you.
That's how
Shantaji,
that's how it struck me.
Aapko kaise shuru hua ye sab? Aapke liye.
Main jab choti thi to mere papa hamesha bolte the, beti tum bada hokar महात्मा गांधी जैसे नाम कमाओ ऐसे कहते थे. तो मैं सोच रही थी अरे अंग्रेजी तो नहीं है, किसके साथ मैं लड़ू. तो जब मैं KSS आई, वहां पे मुझे लाइफ स्किल एजुकेशन ट्रेनिंग मिली, तो उस समय अलार्म बेल जैसे मेरा वो ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम था. मैं सोची जो मेरे मन में अंधविश्वास था मैं उसको दूर की. इसके बाद मैं सोची जो लोगों के मन में, मेरे कम्युनिटी लोगों के मन में है जो अंधविश्वास, उसको मैं दूर करूंगी अहिंसा नीति अवलंबन करके. इसलिए मैंने ये शुरू की. और दूसरी चीज ये है कि मैं सोच रही हूँ कि मैं जैसे आगे आ गई हूँ, तो मेरे कम्युनिटी में जो पीछे रह गए हैं मेरे भाई बहनों, उन लोग को भी आगे ले आऊंगी. इसलिए लीडरशिप क्वालिटी गेटिंग कर रही हूँ उनको, उनके उन लोग के पास जाती हूँ. जब समर वेकेशन में गाँव, तो कुछ लीडर क्रिएट की हूँ उन लोग गांव का क्या प्रॉब्लम है उन लोग अपने से मतलब फाइंड आउट करते हैं और कैसे सॉल्व करेंगे उन लोग बताते हैं तो ये सब बहुत अच्छा चीज है कि अपनी कम्युनिटी के लिए आप अपने से काम कीजिएगा
वेरी गुड Pritish, tell us what happened to you that caused this.
I think when I changed three cities in my childhood. So first I lived for 11 years in Jaipur. I lived for around a year in Chandigarh, and then I finally moved to Gurgaon, and went to DPS Gurgaon. So here are the things that really changed. The schools that I went to the earlier two places weren't that big. They didn't have the kind of opportunities that a metropolitan city had to offer or a big school like DPS Gurgaon had to offer. And I couldn't fit in. And that's when all the bullying started and all these things started happening. And I couldn't, like right now I can speak to all of you, but at that point of time I couldn't. People used to laugh when I used to speak. So that's how things changed. When I was bullied, I used to cry, and like I mentioned earlier, I think I was bullied in 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, and just went throughout. And in 10th grade, I got a really great opportunity from the Global Leadership and Education Foundation, which is also organizing the event in Mumbai. And the opportunity was about coming up with a social venture. And this was one thing that I really wanted to do. And this is what got me out of that place where I couldn't speak up to giving workshops to around 500 students. My personal experience is something, and what I experienced made me start this initiative.
Wonderful. I'm a big fan of Gauri's work. So TGAF is a great, I work with them quite a bit. Very nice organization. Aditi, tell us about your journey. What was that moment that occurred for you transformed everything?
I'm going to sort of answer this in two parts. One is the organization itself and how it started. Like I said, I'm not the founder, but it was driven by a sense of, if you really sit and analyze economic, political, social problems, it's very hard to turn the attention away from the fact that the education system is at the root of a lot of problems. I don't think anyone here is going to disagree on that. We might disagree on how to go about fixing it, but the education system as a root of a lot of the crises that we see, that was imminent. And I think when you're this young, you can, and you've really, gone through that exploration and reached the end of a problem, you might be able to unsee the problem, but it's really hard to turn away from it. Like, it just drives you to a sense of absolute frustration, because I mean, we're going to be along after everyone's gone, right? And the process needs to really start now. For me, education, similarly, after a journey of some exploration, I went to Rishi Valley School, and after that came back to a very traditional CBSE school, and I just couldn't understand the difference between the two environments. And from there, I started reading and understanding about education, how different environments of education, different programs of education will produce different citizens, will produce a different citizens that you have. So primarily, like, this is just the way I see the world, that you want to understand the world, try and look at the education system and what that's doing. I'm hearing so much about, the fourth industrial revolution and artificial intelligence and all of that, and the school system is just stuck. And I mean, for those of us, all of us who've been in school, we know the frustration and the fact that you can't do anything about it. So just this, the design of this organization is such that you can start making a very structured, long-term change, because finally what everyone's trying to do is change attitudes and mindsets. So for that, you need to promote a skill rather than just relying on spontaneous, this change of heart sort of a thing. So that's how I got involved, and it's all about learning about, right now it's just about, I think as young people we also have a lot of liberty to experiment before we, formalize into something. So it's just been a whole journey of understanding how the education system here works. Okay. Once you get in, you learn.
All right, very good. And Piyush will just tell us about your journey?
So for me, every day when I got up in a good mood, the sun shining outside, birds chirping, and suddenly this bliss faded away at the very sight of the newspaper that I saw, which colorfully explains the detail of all murders, rapes, crimes that happened last night, or what's not working and what's broken. And I realized that this is resulting in a lot of negative actions as well. People are losing trust on the government, they're not trusting each other. In fact, there's this close acquaintance who saw the Nirbhaya case on TV for 3 days straight, and she felt so strongly for it that she committed suicide. So I realized that negative news is actually leading to a lot of negative actions. On the contrary, I was also very lucky to have been interacting with a lot of people in the grassroots level doing incredible work. And I realized that why not to present these stories and let people know that there's so much good happening around and we don't know about it. So I thought if negative news can stimulate negative actions, why can't positive news and motivational stories stimulate and initiate positive actions? So with that thought in mind,
when did you start? When was the beginning of this moment?
Yeah, so I was 18 back then. And
2 years. Long veteran.
Yeah, so I started at 18. And
excellent.
That's how it triggered.
Excellent. I'm going to open it up in a second, but I want to ask one more question. You can all take it whoever wants to go first, right? Is that you're all thinking of college now. You're all at college already. You're at university. You know, you're facing the challenges of running a social enterprise or working in one, right? How do you take this forward? What is your vision to how to manage something like this now that you will be going to university and you'll probably be away for 4 years somewhere? What will happen to this baby that you are creating? You know, what is your vision for it? Who wants to take it first?
So
Okay, go ahead.
So for me, maybe so, it's not just about scaling the organization, but I believe that on a larger scale, that this thing that we have started as a positive news platform, I believe that in the coming years, people are going to consume news in various different forms and mediums, and the impact that news is going to have on us is growing exponentially. So it is, as responsible human beings, it is very important for us to let people know that there's so much good happening. And I believe that it's not just the organization that needs to grow, but I want to influence other media houses, other organizations to increase their, if not put all good stories, but increase their proportion of positive stories in the
news. You're talking about advocacy.
Right.
And how would you do that while you continue your education? What is your feeling? How would you manage your two parallel streams?
So I've been doing it for the last 2 years, and that's a difficult term to achieve, but we are all college students who are working in this, and we go out to other media houses and build up this partnership with other media houses. So we give them stories, we have this cross syndication of stories that has started happening. So we believe that in this changing world, it is very, very important to have collaborations to take everything forward.
Okay, great.
And we're doing it that way.
Well, good luck. And anybody who wants to take it,
yeah.
Why don't we start with you? Go ahead.
Go ahead.
So at Jazba, we say this one thing, that if you're coming up with an idea, make sure it's globally applicable but locally impactful.
Okay.
Globally applicable being that anyone anywhere in the world can do it. So at Jazba, we say, get together a group of people, put on a show, collect some funds, raise some awareness, and donate to a charity. If it's as simple as that. You don't need us there. You don't need the name Jazba on top of it. Anyone can do it. Locally impactful being that there are a lot of issues we know about, but we don't act on in our day-to-day lives simply because no one has put it forward in a way that it's actually going to affect us. And I think these two factors, once you have that in initiative, you can carry it out anywhere. So in our team, a couple of us are planning to go abroad to study. And this is what we want to spread out. You know, take it forward. Don't just have it as a high school thing. Go ahead, create companies that deal with creative
take
solutions.
It with you.
You know, instead of just having IT solutions everywhere, have creative solutions. Try and integrate it into the education however you can. Spread the message. Because it's a domino effect, right? You
it's
set
like
off
a movement,
one person,
in a way.
Yeah, they set off another 100, you know? So
do you see it as a movement that will grow?
Yeah, certainly.
And they'll remember one of you as one of the founders, and it'll grow beyond you.
I honestly don't think I'm required for this. I think anyone can do it anywhere as long as you have that spirit. Because, I mean, I know it's charity and all that, but it's also a very, very enjoyable experience, and it gives a purpose to what you're doing more than anything
Wonderful.
Else. So I think
Wonderful.
Anyone, anywhere can
okay.
do it.
You were going to say, sorry.
So I just made a transition from school to college,
And during my boards, all these things got really difficult. I had all the pressure coming up from my parents that I'm supposed to be studying. And the thing that is really important is that we keep the mission in mind. For example, for us, it is that we want to create enough pressure on the government to actually include something like this in the curriculum, to actually issue guidelines to school that this is something that is really important and you need to be working on. Once we achieve that, I would believe that I am successful, and that is when I will be letting go of this thing. So that's really important that we set our goals and we let go of our things. I mean, I'll be working on this for a lot of years, and it might be difficult for me to leave it there. But there should be an end goal, and we should leave it there and go ahead. And that is something that's really important.
But do you see that there's a need to leave something behind, like a platform or an infrastructure that can be run by other people? Do you feel the need for that?
Yes. So what we are currently doing is we have a well-defined model which we have clearly documented. The way we work through this is that we establish a group in the school itself. So that let's say I establish a team in one school. So that team is going to keep passing on to their juniors, and that is how it's going to be there in that particular school. So it's very important that, let's say, if we have an idea, like you mentioned, that there should be a domino effect, so that can only be there when we have well-structured models. We have well-structured things that people over the world can take up and just work on it.
Yeah.
If I could just add what you said, I think you totally overestimate how much work we're required to do in
college. Oh, I agree.
Most of us are already, we could...
But it's a good thing. It's a nice naivete.
No, I mean,
because it creates change, and that's a very important thing, you know?
No, if something's important to you, you will figure out how to do it, right? Like, I mean, there's so much we're hearing about this myth of busyness. I don't have the time to do something.
Everybody has time.
You have to create the time.
Correct.
To do it. But just building on what he said, I think somebody spoke about building blocks of change. So if you have a well-defined, replicable process which you're using to scale up, then your organization is going to live beyond you.
Correct.
And especially with education, you want something that is, that adapts, that has been thought about, that has enough structure but also has enough flexibility. So we, everybody on the team, we're doing this as our part-time thing. So moving forward, it's still going to be the same. If we've tested that we can do this at a time where all of us are, this is our part-time thing. So even if we go and take jobs or whatever it is, this model still works as that with that part-time commitment. So in some sense, there's that belief that you have created something a little robust, which will sustain itself.
Shanti ji, aap jab ab college kar jayenge abhi, what will happen to this? Iska kya hoga organization ko, aur aap kaise chalayenge?
Pehle to main batana chahungi कि पहले मैं अधिकतर एल्डर लोगों को एम्फसिस देती थी लेकिन मैं भूल गई थी कि बड़ा पेड़ को पानी डालने से क्या होगा छोटे पौधे को ऊपर में पानी डालना है क्योंकि जो बड़ा पेड़ है वो तो बड़ा हो गए हैं जो छोटे पेड़ है उसको उसके ऊपर में पानी डालना है वो ही काल परसों बड़ा होकर फूल होगा और महक सारा दुनिया को महका देगा तो मैं इसके बाद मैं सोच रही हूँ गांव में और स्कूल में जो एडोलेसेंस पीरियड का बच्चे होते हैं उन लोग के पास जाके मैं परिवर्तन का एम के बारे में बताऊंगी बताने के बाद उन लोग को नहीं बोलूंगी फोर्स नहीं करूंगी कि ऐसे ऐसे तुम लोग को करना है मैं बस बोलूंगी कि आपके एरिया में क्या क्या प्रॉब्लम सब है तो उन लोग भी बताएंगे उसके बाद मैं बोलूंगी आप क्या चाहते हैं आप ऐसे ही रहने के लिए आप आगे नहीं चाहते हैं कुछ केस स्टडी में दिखाऊंगी कि इतने छोटे बच्चे इतना आगे गया है आप क्या नहीं चाहते हैं आगे जाने के लिए तो उन लोग भी सोचेंगे नहीं केस स्टडी जब देखेंगे नहीं उन लोग आगे जा रहे हैं हम लोग भी आगे जाएंगे क्योंकि एडोलेसेंस पीरियड में अधिकतर परिवर्तन होता है मन में परिवर्तन होता है तो उन लोग के मन में भी परिवर्तन होगा कि नहीं हम भी आगे जाएंगे और इसके लिए मैं सोच रही हूँ अभी मैं जो एडोलेसेंस पीरियड के बच्चे हैं
What she's saying is that she'd like to work with not elders who have already done this before, the younger children who are coming up that she can educate and help them become leaders like her to take on this project and keep it going. So it grows continuously from the small saplings up to the big tree, basically. Yeah. So that was great. Thank you so much. I'm going to open it up to a couple of questions now. We have about 10 minutes left. So why don't we... we have 10 minutes left? Who's in charge? Yeah. Let's start with you. Is there a mic? Mic here? Yeah, please. And then we'll take one from that side of the room afterwards. Okay. Yeah, okay. Thank you. Tell us your name, sir.
Yeah, I'm Professor Dr. Saurabh Agarwal. And this panel has raised a very important question of change in the education system. And myself, for last decade, I am associated with education. So I'd really like to know from you that if you were to remodel the education system, what kind of 21st century education system you would like, and that could really make a system. Not only schooling, if you can think beyond in graduation and also MBA. Because it's not only in India, even in Harvard, they are saying, how can we do rethinking the new MBA? So I want to hear to some fresh ideas of what we can do into the education system.
So the education system kaise hona chahiye?
Hona chahiye. Thank you.
Who wants to take it?
Should I?
Go on, start.
This question gives me nightmares, but I'll start with what, I used to be very radical about this question and like, oh, you know, we need to like completely start over. But I think that there is a case to be made that we need to be more gradualist about this. We need to, I mean, there's a reason the system has survived for so long, and you're going to encounter a lot of resistance if you just suddenly remodel it. So one thing is that we really have to think in terms of relevance. You know, moving forward, to some people it sounds very alarmist, you know, that oh, the world is really going to change. But it has. I mean, politically, look at the last 2 years, right? Nightmares in some sense. Economically, it's going to change. Technology is going to radically change the way we're doing it. And we're really not paying attention to, you know, looking at the future and working backwards. It gives us enough hints to make a change now. So one is focusing on relevance. Particular measures, I mean, the education system is so huge that one size cannot fit all. And that brings me to my second point, that there needs to be more personalization. One of the reasons SCTI is so close to my heart is because it really gives students a space to exercise their own agency. And, you know, in that entire week, even if there's one SCTI session where they are thinking for themselves, they're speaking for themselves, it's so joyful for them, you know. And that really says something about how top-down education is. So activating student agency, activating student voice is absolutely essential. I mean, I don't know another sector where people running the organization takes so little feedback from people who are consuming the organization or the service provided. Right? Do you listen to students? Do you listen to what they're feeling, what they're thinking? No. Right? We've decided our metrics and we're going along with it, no matter how bullheaded these metrics are.
Well, you see, in the very true. In the educational system, the children are the product. They are not the consumer. The parents are the consumer. Product. They are the product. So they're trying to create the best optimal product they think they should create.
Right, but that's just 20 years ago. And I mean, if you're... Yeah.
But you know, I agree with you. Thank you.
If I may add on a little bit to that.
I like the women taking the role.
As far as just one thing. Can I just answer your question? And to all of you children, I have a redesigned syllabi from standard 8 to standard 12. Where I have replaced English 1 and Hindi, English 1 and English 2 and Hindi 1 and Hindi 2 by communication skills, selling skills, marketing from 8 to 12. My basic aim was that when they leave the school by 12, they're at least ready for the market.
But ma'am, do you have a question?
No, I was just telling.
Oh, okay. Let the kids talk because I really want to hear from them. So just one more point and then I'll take one more question, right? Thank you for sharing that.
Like Aditi said, while we all want so many changes, we still need to be a bit practical about it. So in my opinion, the biggest leap any education system in the world can take is leave a bit of space open for change, because we have certain suggestions now. 30 years from now, it's not going to be the same. And you know, I'm a CBSE commerce student right now. We have a subject called entrepreneurship. It was started 25 years ago, and the textbooks came out for the first time 25 years ago, and the first the material we learned today is what was written then. And we're all talking about it. You know, in our classrooms, our teachers have told us, you know, look at this, it's not relevant anymore. Even they're sick of it. But there's no gateway to actually go in and change it. And when they were discussing that impossibly hard CBSE math paper last year, they didn't consult a single student about it. We have no gateway for that change. So we can talk about making changes in our education system, but until they give us
Very good. Thank you. All right, let me ask you one more question, which is that the organizations like Ashoka, right, that are nurturing you and supporting you in their own way, right, giving you, you will tell us they're giving you, but what is the role that governments, corporations, non-profit large groups like Ashoka can do in helping young entrepreneurs like you create sustainable models that can grow? You know, is it training? Is it money? Is it learning? Tell us what you feel are the most important, three most important things that you think they can give. And keep it short. Keep it, boom, bullety.
Yeah.
Right?
So there's one really interesting thing that Ashoka is currently doing, which is known as the Changemaking Day. What we are trying to do there is that encourage more and more students to take change making as a career, introduce change making everywhere. We say everyone a change maker. That's the Ashoka motto. And that's what we are trying to ask them to do. We want to create more optimist citizens. We want to create more STTIs. And that is how Ashoka is going about it. When we talk about corporates here, I think there was a very interesting video on Facebook that had gone viral, where the person said that in our education system, what we were previously producing was people who could work in factories, and now we need leaders. And that is something that is really important, and that's what the corporate should really ask all these people to do. Now, when we look at college placements, the corporates give you a 2 to 3 month training, even after you have done college, to be able to work in that environment. Then what's the point of our college education? It makes no sense. Mm. So I think corporates should really come forward and interact with all these organizations and all the governmental organizations which create these curriculums to tell them that this is what we need. We need future leaders. We don't need workers now.
Okay, thank you. And Shanti, Ashoka ne aapko kaise help kiya? Aur government or company or private sector kaise aapko help kar sakta hai is kaam mein?
पहले तो मैं बताऊंगी कि ओसका ने जो मुझे यूथ वेंचर हिसाब से मुझे चुने वरना मैं काम करते ही जाते रहूंगी और कोई मुझे मतलब एनकरेज नहीं करते किसी भी चीज में अगर हम काम करेंगे तो एनकरेज नहीं मिलेगा तो हम थोड़ा डॉल फील करते हैं कोई हम लोग को कुछ नहीं बोलते हैं काम करते जाते हैं काम करते जाते हैं अरे सही है कि गलत है कोई नहीं बताएंगे तो हम लोग कैसे जानेंगे कि मैं कितना सही कर रही हूँ कितना गलत कर रही हूँ पर ओसका फाउंडेशन इतना अच्छा जो फाउंडेशन है उन्होंने मुझे आज यूथ वेंचर चुने और मुझे मेरा वर्क पोटेंशियल को मल्टीप्लाई कर दिए कि तुमको करनी है तुम्हारा कम्युनिटी में इतना पीछे रह गया है तुम्हें आगे जाना है और इसलिए तुमको लीडरशिप भी मतलब तुम्हारी कम्युनिटी में लीडरशिप बनाना जरूरी चाहिए क्योंकि मैं सिर्फ अकेली तो नहीं कर पाऊंगी क्योंकि ओडिशा में इतनी कोने कोने में इतने आदिवासियों हैं उन लोग को पॉसिबल नहीं है कि मैं उधर जाके मैं काम करूँ तो अगर गवर्नमेंट या कॉर्पोरेट सेक्टर उन लोग हेल्प करेंगे तो बहुत जल्द ही बहुत कम दिन में ही
तो हेल्प कर सकते हैं स्केलिंग में बढ़ाने में
जी सर
पूरे स्टेट में ना अच्छा बट आई वांट टू एंड ऑन अ रे ऑफ सनशाइन विद यू बिकॉज़ ही इज मिस्टर सनशाइन राइट ही इज मिस्टर हैप्पीनेस हियर यू गॉट अ चैलेंज ऑन योर हैंड्स बिकॉज़ यू नो ब्रिंगिंग हैप्पीनेस टू अ मिजरेबल वर्ल्ड इज अ गुड यू नो एक्टिविटी एंड आई एम वेरी प्लीज्ड टू बी सीइंग इट हैपन What do you think you can do to bring a coming together of these like corporates like media houses and non-profit sector like Ashoka and funding agents like governments and how can it all come together in your mind to bring happiness to a larger number of people?
So I feel that it's high time for people to realize and take young people more seriously, because wherever we go, we get knocked off. And after getting the Ashoka Fellowship, we have got the opportunity to go and talk and interact with people on the name of Ashoka. So that has been really, really helpful.
Ambassadors.
Yeah. And also about the fact that the distribution of resources in terms of finance, in terms of training resources, it has been really disproportionate. Like in city from that I come from, in Bhopal, we don't have this ecosystem of startups. We don't have people to talk about, and we don't have people who will guide us. So I think the distribution of resources should be more in a proportional manner, and it should go and reach to grassroots levels and not just metro cities. I think that will bring up more young people like us to kind of do more good work and change this beautiful world.
Very good.
I
know you all have many things to say, but if anybody has questions, please ask them during the lunch break. You know, I'm sure people will be mobbing you just now. You know, you're like superstars of the event, so well done. And but I think we've hit our time, and I wanted to thank all of you.
Thank you.
For
thank
doing
you
what you're doing.
Thank you for inviting.
And thank you all for listening. And, you know, well done.
Thank you.
Get up and take a bow. Get up. Just 1 minute, yeah.
I think that's awesome. When we talk about social needs, we normally talk about the basic needs like food, energy, healthcare, water, sanitation, and all stuff. But I think this is a different dimension. And that dimension is coming from the fellows who are less than 20 years of age. And if these people can think like this, then I'm very sure tomorrow there is going to be so many more like them who can really make a difference. Very good. And I would like to present them a small memento. Thank you very much.